The views and opinions expressed on Detroit Wants to Know with Steve Hood are not those of WADL TV 38 or Adele Broadcasting Corporation.
Detroit Wants to Know is brought to you by Venn Johnson, attorney and counselor, Johnson Law PLC.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Detroit Wants to Know. You're watching TV 38 WADL, and we're coming to you from the lovely Doubletree Hotel in downtown Detroit. This week, ladies and gentlemen, on Tuesday, we will get a chance to vote in a Republican primary. Right now, we have Mitt Romney, Rick Santorum, Ron Paul, and Newt Gingrich. Vote in a Republican primary, you say? That sounds crazy, as us Democrats. For Detroiters, we don't usually vote in those. I'm here to introduce you to somebody that actually shook the foundations of the Democratic Party and now has them giving permission to vote in the Republican primary. My main man, Ernest Johnson. Ernie, what's happening, man? What have you done?
We wanted to shake it up. We wanted the Republicans to spend as much money as they bring in, more money than they bring in. So right now, Romney and I'm Willie Romney and all the rest of them are spending more money than they bringing in fighting each other. The more they fight each other and spend all their money, the less that they use to, against our president, Obama.
Well, what is this with Ron Paul? Why are you trying to get people to go vote for Ron Paul?
Well, we picked Ron Paul because he's the least electable, plus he has shown the most respect to President Obama. Rick has challenged his religion. He has re-challenged, you know, everything about the president. And Romney has been off the hook. So they have went below the belt against. They have not only insulted the president, but they have insulted the office of the presidency. Okay.
Now, you and Milt Jugatis started this whole issue off, and then I guess a couple weeks ago we heard the Democratic Party came to your side of things. They were against you at first.
Right. They had a rule that if you voted in the Republican primary, you could not vote in the Democratic caucus May 5th, which they voted, and it was almost unanimous that now Democrats are free to vote. You do not have to declare that you're a Republican to vote for to get a Republican ballot and vote in this primary. All you got to do is go Tuesday or go today or tomorrow, any day of the week, you can go and pick up a ballot and ask for a Republican ballot and just darken in Ron Paul and you through in 10 minutes.
Okay, now this was just a Detroit thing started by you and Mildred Gaddis, but I understand it's gone statewide?
Right, right. I spoke at the Baptist conference last week at Galilee. Reverend Chapman had a Baptist convention there last week, and we had a lot of ministers from across the state. And we had these flyers that they are going to be taking back to their churches and preaching from the pulpit. You know, this race is on districts. The 13th and the 14th district is in Detroit. There's only 30 delegates in the state of Michigan that's gonna be awarded for this election. Detroit, Michigan had a 13th and 14th district, so we get between 4 and 6 delegates here. And so we figured if we get Paul 6 delegates, there's 24 up for grabs. If the rest of those candidates in the Republican primary can get half, 12, that means Romney loses. If he get less than 16 delegates in Michigan, he loses even if he get the most votes because it's all about the delegates.
Well, this is an out-of-the-box strategy to disrupt the the Republican convention. It's okay because I personally think it's going to be a brokered convention, and I think their candidate's actually going to be Jeb Bush out of Florida. And what if that happens, it's automatic victory for President Obama because their voices will not have been heard.
Right, because there's only 3 months left when they had their convention is in August. So it's 3 months before the election, and that means our president will still be sitting on $1 billion and the pulpit, and you know he's running as the incumbent, and they would not, and nobody don't want no more Bushes. You know, we're tired of the Bushes.
Okay, where can people find out their polling locations?
You can go online. The Secretary of State now has it online, and I hope it'll be in the Chronicle tomorrow, but it is online that you can find out where your polling location is. Okay. And so the polls are going to be open from 7 to 8, Tuesday, February 28th. We urge everyone to go out and vote. Do not make the mistake of voting for President Obama, because that'll be a spoiled ballot. And his name is on there, too.
And you want them to vote for Ron Paul.
Vote for Ron Paul. That helps President Obama.
Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here. Ernest Johnson says, go out and vote for Ron Paul. Upset the apple cart. We'll be right back from the Doubletree Hotel in downtown Detroit.
Facing a legal crisis? Then you need me. Ben Johnson. The courtroom is my office, and I'm out to win. I have the trial experience that matters. That's why I can take on the big guys and win. I've tried and won more jury verdicts than any other plaintiff attorney, because I refuse to lose and I never back down. I'm Ben Johnson. I fight for your rights. Call me today.
Detroit Wants to Know is sponsored in part by the Wellness Plan Medical Centers, with three locations to serve you. Call 875-4200 to schedule an appointment.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. You're watching TV 38, and you're watching us from the Doubletree Hotel in downtown Detroit. It's a lovely place. I have Eric Sabree with me. Eric, you're from the Treasurer's Office. How many people are losing their houses?
Yeah, I'm from the Treasurer's Office. I'm a Deputy Treasurer for Land Management. I work for Raymond Wojtowicz, the Wayne County Treasurer. And this year we sent out 42...
Don't forget his title, ladies and gentlemen. Go ahead.
We sent out 42,000 notices for tax foreclosure.
42,000? Right. Now, are those 42,000 people going to be out on the streets?
No. Last year, I'll give you an example. Last year we had 26,000 notices that went out informing people that if they didn't pay their taxes, they would be subject to tax foreclosure. And we were able to enter into payment agreements with 14,000 people.
That's a high percentage.
So we were able, and out of that, 70% paid.
Okay.
So we are using these programs to help people stay in their homes. The Treasurer does not want anyone's property.
You're sure about that?
We're sure about that. And it doesn't benefit us at all, but he's responsible to collect taxes.
Well, the reports I got from your show cause hearings were that the people were treated with dignity and respect. Earlier this, last year, there was another event with DTE where people's faces were pressed up against the window. But you guys really handled that well at Cobo Hall, and I want to take my hat off to you. Now, you've been all throughout the community promoting this.
Yes. Every weekend, we're at community groups, at churches, talking about how to save your home. The main thing we want to do is help people to relax, not to panic. We've heard cases where individuals have received our notices and actually moved out of the house because they thought they were going to be evicted. And the Wayne County Treasurer's Office has never evicted anybody. Mm-hmm. We've never evicted a person from their home. But we have to have an auction. If they don't pay or don't enter into a payment agreement, then they're probably subject to go to the auction in September or October and could be sold. So we have two programs. One is the stipulated payment agreement, which will allow an individual to take their 2009 and prior taxes, divide it by five, and make five payments between March 31st and October 10th. Mm-hmm. If that's not an option for them, they can't make the regular payments, we have what we call distressed owner-occupant extension. Mm-hmm. This allows the taxpayer to stretch their payment till December 12th. Mm-hmm. However, interest continues to accrue on all the unpaid balance.
Is it really at 18%?
Really is 18%, 1.5% per month.
That's like one of them check-and-go stores.
That's worse than some credit cards, yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, where do people go to enter these agreements, and what is the deadline? One more time.
The deadline, March 31st. You can come to the 400 Monroe office, fifth floor. You can also call our offices, 224, area code 313-224-6105. Mm-hmm. Or area code 313-224-5990.
If people want to pay by credit card, can they do it online?
They can do it online with credit card. Mm-hmm. If they come down to our offices, they have to have cash, cashier's check, or money order.
So do not bring your credit card down.
Don't bring
to the
your
office.
Credit card to the office yet. Don't bring a personal check if it's for delinquent taxes.
Don't bring a personal check
for delinquent taxes.
No bounce checks.
Right. We had a few hundred thousand dollars worth of bounce checks last year, and we are not going to have them this year.
Okay. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it. The deadline's looming. Don't lose your house. The treasurer doesn't want your house. You can pay online, by credit card, or you can go down to the treasurer's office, pay by cashier's check or money order or cash. Eric Sabree, thank you very much. You're doing a wonderful job. Say
thank
hello
you.
To Dave Szymanski, the deputy treasurer, and say hello to old man Wytowicz for me. I love that guy.
All right. Thank you, Steve.
All right.
All right.
We'll be right back.
Detroit Wants to Know is sponsored in part by the Wellness Plan Medical Centers, with three locations to serve you. Call 875-4200 to schedule an appointment. Detroit Wants to Know is sponsored in part by the Associated Food and Petroleum Dealers, AFPD, the voice of the independent retailer.
Detroit Wants to Know is Detroit Television's most energetic and engaging half hour. If you and your company would like to advertise to Detroit Wants to Know's ever-growing audience, send an email to sales@stevehooddetroit.com. Don't miss your chance to touch thousands of Metro Detroiters each week.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. You're watching TV 38 WADL, and we're coming to you from the lovely Doubletree Hotel in downtown Detroit, an amazing facility. But ladies and gentlemen, it's a sad week. A nine-month-year-old became the 48th murder victim in Detroit. This has got to stop. And I'm at my wit's end. I don't know what to say. I don't have an explanation for it. So I thought we'd look back in history and actually try and glean some answers from one of our civil rights hero. I want to introduce you to the original recording secretary of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. I want to introduce you to my father, Nicholas Hood Sr. Dad, welcome.
Well, thank you very much, Steve. It's good to be here with you.
We saw a nine-month-year-old killed this year. I've got to ask you, what does Dr. King's legacy really mean in terms of today, what we're seeing today?
Well, Dr. King's legacy is nonviolence, and of course, what we're seeing now is violence, and it doesn't make any sense at all. And until the whole community rises up and puts a stop to it, it's not going to happen. For example, with everybody in that house, somebody in that house knows who's out there shooting that gun. Now, they're the first ones they ought to start with, because somebody in that house got off track with somebody out there with all those guns. So the police ought to start with who everyone in that house and find out who they know and who they had crossed up.
Now, back in the old days, I remember, well, I don't remember, but I heard tell, you actually had to negotiate with the Black Panthers back in the 68.
Well, yeah, those were some difficult days. They were holed up in a house somewhere on the east side, and in the middle of the night, they got all the members of the council out to come out to their neighborhood to try to negotiate some kind of truce. It was unbelievable. Another night, they were demanding $1 million or something, and actually, the bank president of National Bank of Detroit got the money out in the middle of the night, and it didn't go through, but the whole council, spent the night waiting to negotiate with these people. It was a crazy time.
Those were crazy times, but you all made it through. You redeveloped the medical center. You did all sorts of stuff, basically as part of King's legacy. So tell us how that all worked.
Well, let me say that Dr. King not only worked to liberate Negroes in the South, but his concern was to break down racial segregation all over America. So his big program was getting the Congress to enact a civil rights law that would affect everyone. We weren't free here in Detroit. I was in Detroit at that point. That was in 1963. I was here. And this hotel, a member of my church was the maitre d' here, and it was segregated. The restaurants were
segregated.
And now
it's black owned.
oh, it's black owned now. You wouldn't want anything. It's finer now than it was then. But what I'm saying is, Negroes in Detroit weren't liberated, and especially in the medical center, where those behind the medical center wanted to bring receiving into that complex. They wanted to bring children's into that complex. But when they found out, the new civil rights law said you cannot get any money until you desegregate overnight, instead of just having two black certified physicians on their staff, they opened it up. And even the medical school, the nursing school were all segregated. Dr. King's legacy is that he opened up a whole lot of things up north that had been closed, but nobody was talking about it.
Have we squandered his legacy, Dad?
Well, I don't know that we've squandered his legacy, but we've certainly not carried out the nonviolent part of it. The kind of violence we see in Detroit is not what Dr. King was proposing for the whole nation. We think he was just talking about nonviolence with the white folk, but we need nonviolence in the black community or we're going to fall apart completely.
Mm. Okay, what do you see on the horizon for Detroit?
Oh, I see nothing but good. Actually, in Detroit, you read the newspaper, you see a tale of two cities. You see the economic front going down Woodward Avenue with Dan Gilbert, and on the other side of Woodward, you see the city council fighting for its life, but the commercial community is going on with or without the city council, and I think it's exciting. It's a tale of two cities.
Back in the old days, did you all fight like this city council does?
No, we really had a togetherness, and we didn't have a lot of under-the-table dealing. The business community and the political community were basically united. And I'm indebted. I was the second black elected to the council, but I'm indebted to the larger community for coming together with the black community and electing me and subsequently electing many black leaders to our city government. So the equation has changed a bit now, where we don't have the kind of togetherness that we once had, but until we get that, we're not gonna make it.
Okay. Well, Dad, I want to thank you for coming out today. I hope you'll stick around for the tour of this place.
Well, let me say, I just want to congratulate you. This is about your 54th week.
54th week.
With this show.
Uh-huh.
And you started from zero, and you're going right to the top of the charts, and I really appreciate that.
Thanks, boss. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back, and we're going to come back with the owner of the Doubletree of this hotel. You're going to be amazed. It's a story of African-American empowerment you don't want to miss.
Facing a legal crisis? Then you need me, Venn Johnson. The courtroom is my office, and I'm out to win. I have the trial experience that matters. That's why I can take on the big guys and win. I've tried and won more jury verdicts than any other plaintiff attorney, because I refuse to lose, and I never back down. I'm Venn Johnson. I fight for your rights. Call me today.
Detroit Wants to Know is Detroit Television's most energetic and engaging half hour. If you and your company would like to advertise to Detroit Wants to Know's ever-growing audience, send an email to sales@stevehooddetroit.com. Don't miss your chance to touch thousands of Metro Detroiters each week.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. You're watching TV 38 WADL, and we're coming to you from the Doubletree Hotel in downtown Detroit, the Pickfort Shelby. You heard my father say in the last segment that this hotel was segregated years ago. Now it's African-American owned. Emmett Moten, proprietor, owner, welcome to Detroit Wants to Know. Mm-hmm. How did you do this?
Thank you, Steve. Well, it's a group of us that got together, and it's when you back into a project, you know, and as you know, been dealing with real estate development for the last 30 years. And, you know, looking at a property like this, it takes a lot of people to come together. And I think we were fortunate when you do something like this, to have the right people on the team to make something like this happen. We had the right financial people, and we had the right builder designers. We had Larry Brinker, L.S. Brinker.
Really?
He did it all by himself.
An African-American construction company.
$93 million.
Wow.
By himself. And you know, when you go through things like this, you always have issues called a bond. You know, so we were able, along with the lenders and all, to work through that. And Larry Brinker Sr., persons are excellent interior persons. So we felt comfortable dealing with his company because of his skill sets and interior design and what have you. A lot of things that were done in a hotel in terms of restructuring the hotel was done really a lot with his vision, his creativity, and his ability to implement in the building, you know.
Okay, well, tell me about the hotel itself. How many rooms does it
have? Well, 200 and we decided to go from 800 to 203 all suites. This is an all-suite hotel. So it's not, you don't have 30 suites and 100 rooms. It's all suites. And it's a hotel that that has a conference center. The Conference Center Association, we are listed on theirs. Every room that's a meeting room meets the qualifications of the Conference Center's Association. We're very fortunate to have that. We don't have big banquet space, but we have two large rooms. One is the lower level room, and the other one is the upper level, which we call the Crystal Ballroom. That was completely redone. It's a very, very nice space. It accommodates anywhere from 200 to 220 people. So weddings that are anywhere from 120 to 180 people, functions, you know. So we enter that market to get that group that fits. And we have, from a food service standpoint.
Yeah, tell me about the restaurants.
Well, we have a Finn and Porter, which is a steakhouse seafood. And every Friday there's a soul food.
And let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that soul food buffet is not a big boy soul food buffet. That's some serious grub on that soul food buffet.
Absolutely. And then we have the Round Bar, which is opens 11:30 and closes at 12 at night, and it deals with lunches and salads, etc. So we're very fortunate to have that. Plus, we have the Bear Claw, which is a coffee shop. And Bear Claw, the people who own Bear Claw, is out of Chelsea, Michigan.
Okay.
So we try to use local folks. One interesting thing, when we were dealing with the interior design, the furniture, we were committed to look at local. Can we find somebody in America that could build furniture? Well, we did. We found some Amish people in Ohio. They did most of the furniture in the room.
This is an Amish chair?
This is not an Amish chair, but the rooms are Amish.
Okay.
This came out of China, out of California, but mainly out of China, which a lot of big hotel brands won't get their stuff from. We said, well, why do we have to get stuff from China? You know, can we get something locally? That group of folks that did this, did the JW Marriott in Chicago, everything in the JW is Amish. So we just like Brinker, we just said, look, we could find somebody locally, an African-American, but also a qualified African-American that could do this. And this is all his work. And a qualified group of people that could do furniture design. Then we have the apartments, which are built as condominiums.
Right. You have how many apartments do you have?
56.
In this place? 56 apartments.
We have on each floor, there's 5 units per floor. There's 1 bedroom on each floor, one bedroom unit, which is about 920 square feet. And then we have 2 bedrooms and 3 bedrooms. And they average from 14 to 16 on the 2 bedrooms and 1,800 on the 3 bedroom.
Square feet.
Square feet, right. Okay. Square feet. Thank you. Square feet. So, and from the 11th up to the 23rd floor.
Okay.
Plus, we have two penthouses on the
23rd. I saw the penthouse the other day when we were looking through.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
amazing.
Yeah.
I just want to switch gears for one second. Mm-hmm. To young African entrepreneurs, okay, young entrepreneurs, period, and that wanted to get in the hotel business, what 3 things would you tell them? Because you weren't originally in the hotel business. You were in the food service industry at one time, but you haven't been in the hotel industry. What would you tell them?
Well, if you go in any business, you got to know what you're doing. And one thing we know is that running a hotel is not our forte, but business is. So we brought Hilton in as our management partner.
Okay.
So we got the people who understand the business. and we're very fortunate. So they manage the property for us. On the residential side, we got Formidable, local. They manage the apartments. So I think when you're in business, you gotta take your strong suit. You don't be embarrassed to say, well, somebody's better than this is a group that can deliver better than I can. And it's always a team approach. Get the best people on your team.
Okay.
And that's the approach I would say. Whatever you want to do, get the best folks to operate for you.
Okay.
You know, try to do everything yourself. I know all this. There's other people out here.
One last question. It's a yes or no because we got to go.
Mm-hmm.
Are you bullish on Detroit, Emmett Moten?
I've always been bullish on Detroit.
Okay.
And I think that we're going through a period right now that we saw in 1981. And your father was here earlier, and it was his leadership on the city council was able to get us through a $285 million deficit at that time.
Okay.
The unions came together,
so.
And we're seeing that happen today. And then we're seeing the economy. We're seeing people begin
back.
To do things like Quickham,
right.
The Illiges, and other folks in the area beginning to do something. The Fords. I mean, it's happening.
Okay.
It'll take a little time, but it's happening.
All right. Emmett Moten, thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve.
And we'll be back, ladies and gentlemen. Get ready for Get Up and Enjoy Detroit.
Get Up and Enjoy Detroit is sponsored by Entertainment Express Limousine and Luxury Coach. Clean, safe, courteous door-to-door service is just a phone call away. Call 313-277-5000 and reserve your ride today.
Time to Get Up and Enjoy Detroit with Brittney Mabry.
Thanks, Steve. Now, we all know growing up as a young lady in today's society can be extremely difficult. The Detroit Boys and Girls Club is offering weekly mentoring sessions in order to give our ladies some guidance. In order to find out how you can sign up your youth or to become a volunteer, make sure you check out our website at stevehooddetroit.com. Now, spending time together as a family is extremely important, but finding something that the entire family will like is even more difficult. I think the Fisher Theater has done something that will please everybody. The Fisher Theater is hosting Shrek the Musical. This is the story of all the fairy tale's misfits and how they fall in love and form a bond. If you like the movie, you will love the musical. Here until March 11th, tickets start at just $26. Now, if you love a good theater performance, but you don't like the whole family-themed musical, then you should head down to Wayne State University to their Hillbury Theater, where they're hosting Summer in Smoke. This is the story of the struggle between spiritual devotion and the power of your physical desires. Find out what happens up until April 11th. Tickets are just $25. Now, I want to end this show with something that will get jazz, pop, rock, and gospel all in one artist. There's a night with Rochelle Farrell at the Motor City Soundboard. On March 1st, tickets are just $19.
That sounds fun, Britt. I think it's going to be a good time getting up and enjoy the trade. I like that spiritual conflict between the physical and the
and
emotional.
A good story.
Ladies and gentlemen, have a great week and get up and enjoy Detroit. Think it ain't illegal yet. No, really, though.